Are talking about a gigabit to your mobile phone?
Wow, that's astounding. Well, hang on, let's say hello to Lena Marvin. Lena, you there?
I am. Hello. Oh,
hey, how you doing?
Very well.
Okay, Dave started to preview something we're going to talk about a little bit later, gigabit wireless to your phone, which is astounding. But before we get into that, I was wondering if you wanted to talk a little bit about Chaos Communications. I understand you've been checking that out. Okay. Go. So, what is it?
Last year I got to go to Chaos Communication Camp, which is outside of Berlin, and it's this big hacker conference that happens every 4 years outside. But it is also part of the Chaos Computer Club, which hosts the Chaos Communication Congress, which is an annual hacker conference, and it's the largest. It's one of the largest of that kind, so it's like DEF CON, which is in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
And what's really great is I was just watching a absolutely wonderful talk on the a security audit of the U.S. presidential election as presented at the hacker conference in Hamburg in Germany.
Whoa, and wait, back up now. A security audit? What is that?
So you know how when we vote, there's all these different voting machines.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a information security expert, two of them, Matt Bernard and J. Alex Halderman, who are talking about what went down with the election this year, and this is a video that went up today.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they just did this live talk, and now, even though I'm sitting in St. Louis, Missouri, I can watch this talk that happened a little while ago today in Germany,
mm-hmm.
all about how our U.S. presidential election was potentially hacked.
Lena, why don't you tell people where to find this video? What's
Absolutely.
The URL?
media.ccc.de. And once you're on that site, just search for the word recount.
Yeah.
Wow. So that's
known for a long time that the voting machines could be cracked. Lots of people, like Princeton professors, have been doing it just to prove that they can. Have they actually caught anybody doing it?
These are, I believe, the professor types who are talking about how they did it. But it was a great talk, and there's so many great talks. And what's great is they're live streaming. So if you are interested, this is happening the conference goes on until Friday, and as it goes, live streams are being broadcast, and you can log in. And just click on stuff, media.ccc.de.
Okay, now what is the conference? Tell us a little bit about what Chaos Communications is, Lena.
Absolutely. So Chaos Communication Camp is it's part of this. It was organized originally by this group, Chaos Computer Club, which was or is Europe's largest association of hackers. So the way they describe themselves, which I absolutely love, is a galactic community of life forms independent of age, race, sex, or societal orientations, which strives across borders for freedom of information.
Okay, that's pretty comprehensive.
Right? So what they're pushing for is transparency in government, freedom of information, human rights to communication.
Mm-hmm.
And they're an absolutely fascinating group with a long history. They were established back in 1981, and they've been hosting this Congress, this annual event, for ages. I think it's been going on since 1984.
Wow.
And it's moved around from being in Hamburg or in Berlin, but it's a huge conference.
Mm-hmm.
It sold out so totally that I think there's a second, like, rollover conference that people can go to, but I wasn't able to find information on that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's all available online, and it's years of video are actually available online from that media.ccc.de site I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
So you can actually look into it and see all of this history stuff. Now, you might think, well, I don't know that much about hacking, or I don't speak German. Those are both fine points. Many of the talks are in English. It's a fairly good mix between English or German for the languages they're presented in. But the talks range from hardware and information security to ethics, society, entertainment, arts and cultures, security. It's kind of all over the place, and I've just lost myself in these videos of this most recent Chaos Communication Congress.
Well, let's back up a moment. I want to hear a little bit more about this security audit of the election process. I mean, did they come to any conclusions?
Well, I only got 28 minutes into the one-hour talk, but it was actually talking about how Jill Stein was able to raise money to do audits in various states. I think they ended up settling on Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. It still requires this court order. I haven't found the answers yet.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What are some of the other things that they're talking about? Anything that piqued your interest?
Sure. There was a talk about this one I thought might be of interest to you guys. How do I crack satellite and cable pay TV? Analysis of and low-cost attack techniques against the conditional access and scrambling systems used in tens of millions of TV set-top boxes in North America. A case study of the low-cost techniques used by an individual hacker to successfully crack a major pay TV system.
Wow. And is that legal to talk about that stuff over the air?
I don't. The question of whether or not it's legal is a bit moot. When I went to watch this talk, I could not understand it.
Okay.
It was so technically intense. Like, I don't know what a binary analysis using IDA and homebrew PU simulators means, or data logging and injection of SPI and serial TS data.
But I bet if you wrote to the people you hear talking, or some of the organizers, they can put you in touch with the people who can teach this to you.
Oh,
you can learn these things.
And get full files of the, like, you can follow back and see how people built this. Like, the information that they're providing. The question of legality is absolutely a serious question. My guess is no, depending on how you're defining legality. One of the things I find frustrating is when talking to people who are not in technology community about, oh, I'm so excited, I'm watching these hacker talks that are happening in Germany, and I'm watching them here, and it's free, and it's interesting, and I'm learning things, is the immediate response of, oh, is Snowden there? Oh, is Julian Assange there? And it's like, well, that's part
they
of
often
it,
are.
But no.
Yeah, Snowden calls in and comes in with video routinely to events like this. He's in Russia to protect himself against the goons from the government. He's not there because he's trying to hide from people. Mm. He's trying to get the word out.
Well, he's a superstar, isn't he? Among the hackers? He's a superstar.
Not just among the hackers. At least a third of the parliamentarians in Germany wanted to invite him to Germany with asylum in order to testify about how the United States was tapping the phone of the president of Germany and everything else in Germany. Mm-hmm. And they wanted his testimony. So to a lot of people, he's a hero. Mm-hmm. It looks like Obama doesn't have the courage to pardon him before he leaves office. That's one of the about 300,000 people that Obama should be pardoning but isn't. We were talking about that. When we finish with the chaos, let's go to one of the great movies of the year, which is 13.
Okay, well, let's let Lena finish the chaos stuff, because I'm interested in some of the other stuff that you ran across. What other kinds of content are they talking about?
Because of my profession of being a librarian, I was very interested to learn about a woman who's designing an anthropology book for children using open source technology online to help children understand what privacy was.
Hmm.
Not what it is, but anthropologically.
Past tense?
Yeah. It was a really interesting talk.
Mm-hmm.
But there's all sorts of great talks, and I just want to emphasize, these are free to view online,
mm-hmm.
and they're deep. They are interesting. They range on being about virtual reality and art to being about biohacking, about science, so genetic mm-hmm. codes and what they tell us about ourselves and everyone else is a mm-hmm. talk that's going to be happening on Friday.
Okay,
so that's media.ccc, Chaos Computer Camp, .de, as in Deutschland.
Yeah.
media.ccc.de. I've looked at the schedule. There's about 24, 48. There are about 200 talks over 4 days.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
The majority are in English. And I guarantee you that if you care at all about how our world is changing because of technology or about what's inside the technology, you'll find a dozen that you'll want to listen to.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, one of the things that I like about this type of conference that you're talking about, Lena, is that you get a world view that you don't often experience with U.S. media. To me, U.S. media is very insular in the way that they look at the world. They talk about the U.S. and how everything impacts us, but they don't really have the global view. And it sounds like this conference is kind of has a much wider perspective on what's going on across the planet.
Well, the U.S. is falling further and further behind in almost everything.
Mm-hmm.
Software may be the exception. I'm not even sure about that.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about the latest advanced wireless.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a single company in the United States that could build it. They're in Germany and Korea and China.
Wow.
I don't think I agree with the assessment that it's actually talking about global issues because it's so niche.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's going to any professional conference, like, they're talking about some broad ideas, but I don't actually think it's neither global nor local in nature. Because I one of the things I watched was all about hacking a PS4, which is a video game system,
mm-hmm.
and getting it to do what you want. And it was so deeply technical that there's really no, there's nothing American or European or anything about it. It's just tech.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But
there's another session there about, since Snowden, is Germany really fighting for privacy? And Khashoggian, who's one of the three or four most important privacy defenders in the U.S. at the ACLU, made the trip and is over there and is also talking. So there's so much there that whatever you want to find, I think you could find it.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Fascinating stuff, fascinating stuff. Now, Dave, did you want to talk a little bit about that movie 13 before we leave the subject matter of the election and the engineering and hacking of the election system? I know you had a couple of comments.
Okay.
I haven't
we don't
seen
live in
film.
A democracy. We've always known that. We know that when the Constitution came out, Negroes were 3/5 of a person and weren't allowed to vote. We've got lots of that history, and it's coming back again in a way that would easily have swung the election far more than any plausible hack. I didn't realize this, but there are 10 million people with felony convictions in the United States, and in most states, they are not allowed to vote.
Mm-hmm. This is after they've served their sentence and they're out. They cannot vote.
Right. Now, we know something about these people because we know who gets arrested in America.
Mm-hmm.
They're mostly people of color, black and Latino men. That's not because they're more dope dealers who are black or Latino. I assure you that when I went to Colombia, it was the rich kids who had more dope.
Mm-hmm.
And some of their dope dealers were not necessarily black or Latino. By any survey, there's many drug users who are white as black in proportion to the population. In other words, if you arrested white people as often as you arrested black people for drug crimes, 9 out of 10 would not be black.
Yeah, it's all about the enforcement focus. You know, I have a business partner, Doug Frazier, who's been saying for at least a decade that the criminals are the folks that the police arrest. So where do they put their focus? That's who the criminals are. And in this country, it's been black and brown people since slavery days.
Absolutely. And that means if you decide that somebody who stole the car when he was 19 and is now 47 is not allowed to vote, that means you're disenfranchising millions of black men.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason they're disenfranchised is not because there's a moral reason to keep them away because they're going to vote for crooks, but because the legislatures that are mostly pretty conservative know that most of them are going to vote for Democrats, not Republicans.
Mm-hmm.
That was literally several million votes that didn't happen in this election. Hillary won by 2 million votes. It wasn't enough in the Electoral College. It would have been 4 or 5 million if we didn't put people away.
Yeah.
And that's always in my... I hadn't realized that was... 13 is an incredible movie. It's Ava DuVernay, who did the Martin Luther King movie that should have won the best movie of the year, and is extraordinary. And she doesn't need the rhetoric.
Mm-hmm.
It's just facts, just facts, facts, facts. Mm-hmm. And it's overwhelming. It's made by a great filmmaker. Mm-hmm.
And where is it available? How can folks see it, Dave?
It's in movie theaters.
Oh, okay. It's a theatrical release.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Theatrical. And I'm forgetting whether it's one of the 11 movies that Netflix has up for Academy Awards. Mm-hmm. That we were able to see in screenings in New York. Mm-hmm. Lately. Netflix is bringing in a lot of good movies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sounds like this movie is a real eye-opener for folks that don't really... fully understand the industrial prison complex in this country, and in particular how big corporations collude with local government to fill the jails, the profit-making jails. Pretty eye-opening stuff. That information needs to get out there.
Okay, I've been covering Washington, and the old cliche that we have the best Congress money can buy is unfortunately 90% true.
Mm-hmm.
One of the reasons you see all the nonsense going on there.
Yeah.
But let's take another movie. It's also a great movie.
What's
even
that?
Though it's a terribly made movie, and it uses every cliche in the book.
Mm-hmm. What would that be, Dave?
Three women played an important role in getting John Glenn to the moon.
Ah, right.
Okay. One of them... Literally, John Glenn, who had worked with the team that was doing the calculations, said he wouldn't fly until she had signed off on the latest calculation.
Well, because he wanted to make sure that she
he'd worked
agreed
with, them,
with the numbers?
And, yep. He
wow.
wasn't going to go because they had made some big errors that she had caught before.
Wow. Now, give us the name of the movie again before we get further into it. Do you recall?
And I'm sitting here and I'm
trying to remember.
Not remembering it. It's three black women,
yeah.
Fine actresses,
mm-hmm.
A white director, but he did a reasonable job. And what was special about
the name of it?
Yes.
I believe Hidden Figures.
There you go, Lena. Good
absolutely
job.
Worth seeing, even though, as I say, there's every cliche in the book, and Jenny tore it apart technically.
Mm.
It's such a wonderful story. One of the women, the one that John Glenn insisted do his figures, was a computer. A computer in those days was the woman who sat on a calculating machine and figured all the numbers for NASA in 1969.
Wow.
And in fact, part of the story is about the IBM machine that came in and was blowing the numbers and blowing everything else for a while, and eventually got it to work. Why was this woman a computer? Well, she had a master's in math and was an obvious genius.
Wow.
She couldn't be hired as a black woman at NASA to be an engineer or a mathematician there.
You're kidding. You're not kidding.
I'm not kidding.
Why am I surprised?
That was reality.
Mm-hmm.
And they have all the history and all the examples. There's a really funny bit about how she kept... They said, why are you never at your desk? You disappear for 45 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And it turned out she had to run to the other side of the campus because that was where the colored people's toilets were.
Whoa.
Because they didn't need colored people's toilets in the main engineering buildings.
This is in the 1960s.
This was 69 or 70.
Wow.
Wonderful story, confirmed to be essentially true.
Mm-hmm.
The lady is alive, got a major
medal. Really?
Yeah, she's
excellent.
In her 90s.
Mm-hmm.
Got a major medal a few years back as the story came out.
Mm-hmm.
Great story. Good movie. And it shows you that we have come a far way. So when I say that the reason we're having Donald Trump as president is that millions of black men were not allowed to vote because they would vote for a Democrat, I know that things have gotten better in many ways since I was a kid.
Yeah, well, you know, not just would they vote for a Democrat, but they would vote for maybe the interests of working people and poor people. You know, you opened this subject area talking about the fact that we, as black folks, were only 3/5 of a man under the Constitution and were not allowed to vote. The landowners were the guys that had the vote. So right from the very beginning, this country was about the privileged few making the rules and everyone else just kind of cowtailing and providing the labor to fuel the economy and the wealth of that privileged few. So I don't think that dynamic has really changed very much in over 200 years.
It's changed, it's gotten better, but we can't ignore it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And as we know, even if all men were created equal, women hold up half the world.
Yes, they do, and that's an amazing story. Just to reprise Hidden Figures, movie that's out today, is about three black women mathematicians who were very instrumental in the NASA space program, and in particular with John Glenn's flight. John Glenn, who just recently passed away, Ohio native, by the way, was the first man to orbit the globe in space. And black women were instrumental in putting the math together to make that happen. That's an astounding story. Some more
but
hidden history.
But they were paid as a clerk when
wow.
they were working with and doing better than some of the top engineers.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not like this was some peasant coming on and just turning to be a freak. She had a master's in math.
Mm-hmm. Credential.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No opportunity.
Wow.
Couldn't do it. Couldn't get over the
not even any recognition until 50 years later.
That's the way the world has been far too often.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's not that much better today at Google or Yahoo or Microsoft.
No, they have terrible employment profiles in terms of people of color.
And I believe the folks at the top of those companies want to do something about it. And they don't understand how the imposition of their culture is one of the key reasons.
Yeah, well, they're blind, Dave. They're blind. You know, how they see the world is the way that it is. And at least this is my perspective, they're not open to looking at the world with someone else's eyes. They just can't do that.
Did I talk about this on the air last week, who brought the iPhone to America?
You did mention it, but it's worth saying again.
Okay. Steve Jobs and the Apple people invented the iPhone.
Mm-hmm.
No doubt about it. But it came to America when AT&T decided to take it on and brought that here.
Mm-hmm.
The guy in charge has a strong Cuban accent, even though he left Cuba when he was 8 years old, and he's now retiring.
Mm-hmm.
Never lost the accent.
Mm-hmm.
Worked his way through college as a janitor. Certainly didn't have the style or the polish that would get him a job in a place like Google, where they talk about their hiring. They want something Googly, somebody Googly, they call it.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody who's going to fit in, somebody like them.
Right. That's a cultural fit in.
Ralph mm-hmm. is retiring as the vice chairman of AT&T after an extraordinary career,
mm-hmm.
including being the guy who brought us the iPhone.
Mm.
If he graduated from college today, he probably couldn't get an entry-level job at Google because they, like so many other people, they want folks like themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a terrible price you pay for that because you're cutting yourself off from some of the most capable people in whatever society or whatever group you're in, discrimination hurts the people who discriminate, not just the ones who are discriminated against.
Yeah, that was something I learned in college. That was a difficult lesson, that the exploiters suffer in many ways that we don't see as much as the exploited do.
Well, when
it's a bit subtle, but it's real.
When you were in college, I happen to know which college you went to.
Mm-hmm.
It was Columbia. Gary Becker had just left Columbia to go to the University of Chicago, where some years later, he won the Nobel Prize for the Economics of Discrimination, which showed this most dramatically and made it clear.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody who doesn't realize that discrimination cost both parties hasn't studied economics.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There's no question it's right there.
Yeah.
And one of the fellows who could have been your professor 3 years before happened to be the one who did a lot of the work and got the Nobel Prize
mm-hmm.
for it.
Mm-hmm. Amazing stuff. Okay, we're going to take a brief break. When we come back, we're going to talk a little more technology. Dave is going to tell us about the latest going on with the 5G and IEEE and some other stuff. So stay with us.
Getting better, better, and getting them all the time. I think things are better, better, getting better all the time. I can remember when the poor folks didn't have shoes. They didn't have nothing but the welfare blues. Things are better, better, and getting better all the time. I think things are better, better, and getting better all the time. I think things are better, much better. Or have I gone and lost my mind? Or folks are gone to buying diamond purses, fancy cars, and build a split level houses with their crazy bars. Things are better, better, getting better all the time. But the show ain't getting no better for me.
Wake up one morning, you realize your life is one big compromise. Compromise.
This is Angela Harden, General Manager and Program Director of WHCR 90.3 FM. I will be hosting a brand new show on the station called Paradigm Shift. Paradigm Shift is a show that explores holistic ways of thinking and being. We will look at the effect meditation has on brainwaves, how to heal your body with your mind. We will also look at community gardens, vision boards, earthships, and worker co-ops. And we will talk to people who are living the lives they have always dreamed of. So if you want something more from life, tune in to Paradigm Shift on Mondays from 3 to 4 p.m. I'm your host, Angela Harden. I'll meet you there.
Okay, we're back with the Community and Technology, Stu and Dave. Dave, we were talking about the segue from talking about chaos communications and some voting fraud and technology stuff to what's going on in technology. You have some wireless news for us, huh?
Well, next week you're probably going to read in the New York Times, if you still read the New York Times, that gigabit wireless is close. We've been talking about it here on the air, and the best of the tech press, like Electronic Engineering Times, have been talking about it for 6 months. The New York Times and Le Monde and places like that are going to catch on because at the big consumer electronics show, Qualcomm, who has the chips, is going to have a big announcement. And people are finally going to realize everything is changing in wireless in a wondrous way.
Okay, now what does that mean? There's some folks out there that don't even know what a gigabit is. What are you talking about when you say gigabit wireless? Break it down for the third graders out like myself.
Yeah. As I think I exposed the fancy university you went to earlier in the show and some of the economists you might have studied with.
But still, what is it? I mean,
we know what our nice cell phone is today. Mm-hmm. Verizon says there's 6 to 12 megabits. Sprint and T-Mobile may get you up to 20 and 40 and maybe 50. This is 1,000 megabits.
Wow, so we're talking about the speed with which the phone can connect to the network.
And let me be real clear. You're behind a few walls. You're at the edge of the cell site. Mm-hmm. That gigabit may go down 95%. But it does mean that, and if it's congested with a whole lot of other people sharing the cell, also slows you down. But that does mean that most people, much of the time, will be able to get hundreds of megabits, easily 10 times faster than most people's fast phone today.
Wow.
And half of that's already out there in shipping.
Mm-hmm.
And the other half is going to be shown by Qualcomm, the Qualcomm 835 chip, which I know the specs on, which will probably be in the Galaxy 8 in 3 or 4 months and the Xiaomi phone before that. I don't know whether they're going to show those phones in Las Vegas next week. And that is what is going to be coming. Now, you don't need a gigabit to your phone. I have 200 megabits because I had to get 200 megabits down to get even 20 megabits up from Time Warner.
Mm-hmm.
Jenny does video. We really do need the upstream.
You have that on your phone?
No.
On my cable at home?
Okay. Mm-hmm. It happens to be going through a router that can't go faster than 100 megabits, and I've never noticed.
Okay, now just for the folks out there that may not know the math, a gigabit is 1,000 megabytes.
Right. In other words, 100 times faster than Verizon says they are, which claims they're the best network in America.
Mm-hmm.
They actually can go a little bit faster than that, but not much more. And that's a real speed. You stand with a good line of sight 2 blocks away from a cell tower, and you have the right phone, and not too many people are sharing that tower, and you'll get 800 or 900 megabits with this equipment.
Wow. Now, just, Dave, break it down. The equipment, does the magic and the chips reside in the phone, or is it in the network, or is it a combination?
It's both sides.
Okay.
Now, this is not the 5G stuff, which is mostly hype. That'll go to 20 gigabits, and I saw it running at 20 gigabits on a show floor, but that's 5 and 8 years away. This is something that's actually going to be shipping widely this year and this coming year, 2017, and might even show up in 2017 on AT&T and Sprint, both of which have said they're going to adopt this level of technology.
Wow.
It's a half dozen improvements on what you have in your phone.
Mm-hmm. So now, practically, for the average Joe out there, what's it going to mean? I mean, what can I do that I couldn't do? What
nothing.
Can I do better?
Almost nothing. And that's part of the perspective. Mm-hmm. But what it does mean something you can do now, but you just can't do much of.
What's that?
This capacity means that they're not going to have to cap you at 5 and 20 gigabytes a month, i.e. 2 or 10 hours of video across the whole month.
Mm-hmm.
That with all this extra capacity, which gives you could be used for speed, but could also be used to serve more people on a more regular basis,
mm-hmm.
and let you watch TV not 4 hours a month like your typical Verizon plan has now,
mm-hmm.
but 4 hours a night all through the month.
Wow.
And that's important. And the other thing that you can do with it is if you do it the right way, you're going to be able to get much better speeds indoors and at the cell edge.
Mm-hmm.
So while we talk about this headline, what you get if you're two blocks away pointed right at the cell site,
mm-hmm.
it can be a much more effect on the times when you've got a weak signal that doesn't work very well,
mm-hmm.
or no signal at all.
Mm-hmm.
Something's changing that the smartest people in wireless know.
And what's that?
There's been a limit on wireless. The caps were mostly there for marketing reasons.
Right.
They were too low, but there really was a reason for a cap. We didn't know how to squeeze enough capacity through the airwaves. Spectrum was limited and lots of other technical limits were there. Those are in the past. Right now, we are starting to see 100 cell sites in Japan, 1,000 next year in Japan, 1,000 in China, a fair number in Austria,
mm-hmm.
and sooner or later at Sprint here in the U.S., one of the technological breakthroughs, which is high MIMO antennas, massive mm-hmm. MIMO.
Yeah, you were just in Japan recently and saw some of this technology. Is that right, Dave? Tell us about that.
It turns out that if you've got enough computing power, you can put up, instead of one antenna, you can put up four, which mm-hmm. is now starting to become common, and T-Mobile has already in the U.S.
It's in their cell sites.
In the cell sites,
mm-hmm.
four little ones in the cell phone,
mm-hmm.
and massive. You can put 64 and 128 little antennas up at the cell site in a box that's about the size of that big poster we have hanging behind us right here,
mm-hmm.
right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, which you certainly can put up on most cell towers. Realistic. When you have all those antennas and you have the right calculating power, you can have 3 times, 5 times, 10 times, and soon 20 and 50 times as much going through the same amount of spectrum.
Wow.
And that's suddenly just one of the pieces that is giving more capacity that will allow there to be an enormous abundance of capacity on your cell phone that the unlimited offers may become unlimited up to, 500 gigabytes a month mm-hmm. 3 years
this
from now.
This doesn't sound like something that the marketing guys and the accounting guys are going to like very much, Dave. I know you don't know, but what do you think the big guys are going to do in terms of preserving? They make a lot of money with the overcharges right now with the limits and folks go over. How are they going
to? I'm talking to you about what the technology can do and will do in some parts of the
okay.
world. The competition we don't have in the United States
mm-hmm.
and the vision we don't have in the regulation in the United States is going to hold this back severely, as it already is,
mm-hmm.
but even more so. But they're getting very scared. AT&T has said they're going to have to fire a third of their people in the next few years in order to bring the cost down, because the prices are going to have to come down.
The prices of the service are going to have to come down.
Yeah, what people are going to be willing
time.
To pay.
Mm-hmm.
David Small of Verizon says that all these new technologies we're talking about are bringing his costs down 40% a year.
Wow.
So he can give you 30 or 40% more data at the same price and just make that money. In fact, he was talking to a financial group and he said, what we hope to do is actually get our net up a few percentage points, because when our costs go down 40%, if we're getting the price down 30%, most people are going to be happy.
Wow.
That's the kind of thing that's possible, will happen if we have good regulation or good competition. And I sure as heck don't think it's going to happen everywhere.
Yeah, that's
And what did they do about it? As I say, AT&T's decided to fire a third of their workforce.
So have they actually made that decision, or they
said it to the New York Times.
Okay.
That's their plan over the next few years.
Mm-hmm.
They said that in another place, John Stankey, one of the top five people at AT&T, said that we really have to worry about our survival. We're doing very well now. They're making $20 billion a year. They're one of the richest countries. And one of their top guys is saying we're worried about surviving.
Wow, that's incredible.
Because things like this are changing.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing they're doing is they're trying to get rid of competition. That's why AT&T wanted to spend $39 billion to get rid of T-Mobile.
T-Mobile, right.
It wasn't that they wanted to buy what T-Mobile had.
Mm-hmm.
It was they wanted to have fewer competitors,
right,
so they could keep the prices up.
Mm-hmm.
All of this is going on. Lots of it happens in Washington. And we know that the phone companies will get almost everything they want from Washington for the next few years.
They seem to be cheering the new president-elect as he's teeing up to come in.
I know some of his tech people.
Mm-hmm.
They totally believe government should get out of the way and let things go to the market. They totally refuse to accept that when you only have two or three, four companies there, they're going to wink and nod at each other, all raise prices,
mm-hmm,
and markets only work when there are enough suppliers. And we're not going to have that in the United States in the next 10 years,
mm-hmm,
no matter what we do. So it's going to be hard. It's going to raise prices. Technology is moving so fast that the networks will keep getting better. Comcast is committed to offering a gigabit on the cable system to their 40 million homes,
mm-hmm,
something like that, something like 30 or 40% of the United States within the next 2.5 years.
Wow.
They already have it in 7 cities.
Mm-hmm.
It's working like a charm. So the technology is moving so fast that if you can get cable or wireless, which almost everybody can get, you're going to have a much better service 4 years from now, whether Friedrich Hayek, the god of the conservative economist, or Jeff Eisenach or Donald Trump, or Tom Wheeler, the Democrat, or Susan Ness, Hillary Clinton's good friend who was an FCC commissioner, or Joseph Stalin was running the FCC. Because the technology is moving so fast that it's going to be better. The prices and your choices are going to be affected very much by the rules they make in Washington.
Yeah, that's the part that's hard to predict and certainly not necessarily will benefit the consumer.
It's going to come down, some of it, because even a monopolist would pass on some of these benefits of technology.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll get more, but we're not going to be paying less. That'd be my prediction.
And I think it's too hard to predict.
Mm-hmm.
It's real tricky. You can't use traditional economics to figure out what's going to be the price of something in wireless,
mm-hmm,
because there's not enough competitors.
Right.
So you have to start going into game theory and look at what's happening.
Mm-hmm.
The way I like to look at it is I look at other countries where there's more competition, but they're a lot like the United States,
mm-hmm,
France, Germany, England. Their prices are typically 30 or 50% lower than the U.S.
Because of competition.
Well, it's not because they have better engineers.
Mm-hmm.
AT&T and Verizon have some of the best engineers in the world.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that they know anything that we don't.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that their government is giving them big subsidies. Competition is driving down prices. It's not working very well in the U.S., and I don't have any easy solution to that one.
Now, speaking of competition, Dave, I just saw an announcement by, I'm going to say a new company, but they've been around for about 4 or 5 years trying to get into the market. Globalstar is just announced that they're going to roll out what they call low-power mobile broadband networks.
They have satellite spectrum.
Okay.
And they're going to use some of that spectrum,
mm-hmm,
to offer possibly some mobile service.
Mm-hmm.
Whether that makes a difference is a matter not of whether or not it could, but of how it plays out. There's two others ready to come like that.
And do the same thing.
Potentially becoming a new mobile service for the United States.
Mm-hmm.
One is the folks that were blocked 3 years ago because people said they was going to interfere with GPS.
Mm-hmm.
They're probably going to be allowed. And the other is Dish Networks, which is sitting on enough capacity, enough spectrum, to build two Verizon-sized networks. And it's not doing anything. They're speculating that sooner or later, one of the phone companies are going to need that spectrum and pay them $100 billion instead of the $20 billion that they spent on it.
Wow.
There's plenty of spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
The technology is moving so fast that the capabilities are going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And how that plays out in the real market, game theory, mm-hmm. politics, unknown unknowns.
Unknown unknowns, yeah.
And a whole lot of other things. I can tell you where the technology is going mm-hmm. because I know what I'm seeing. The companies are starting to ship, and I know what's behind that in those mm-hmm. same companies' labs and in the universities.
Mm-hmm. Well, before we leave the Global Star issue, I read, and I just kind of like you to clarify, that one of the things that said that is their low-power mobile service would somehow be an adjunct to Wi-Fi or would increase the capability of Wi-Fi by a third. What are they not? Are they talking about a free service? I can't imagine that they are. But do you have an idea what their business model is?
I know the technology. I don't know what their business model is.
Mm-hmm.
You could make Wi-Fi far more efficient and reliable by using the not very much spectrum that Globalstar has to send control signals, send information to this Wi-Fi hotspot saying, take your power down a little, your users don't need it,
mm.
and that'll let this other Wi-Fi hotspot use more power and get and deliver more to its users. And loads of things like that are technically possible, and people are working on.
Mm-hmm. Putting more intelligence in the network, is that what that is?
Putting in a control panel. That's what Verizon wants to do with the LTEU and LAA. But they're setting it in such a way that it's designed to destroy some of your Wi-Fi or at least hurt it badly
mm-hmm.
because they don't want the Wi-Fi competition.
Mm-hmm. Now, speaking of competition, we were talking a little bit offline earlier about IEEE, the International Electronic Engineering Group, and the fact that they are pushing standards for this so-called 5G. And there's another competitive organization that's kind of on the other side of the fence. Can you tell us a little bit about that struggle?
Okay. The way standards are really made for your cell phone, when I say there's going to be this gigabit wireless using 4x4 MIMO and four bands of 20 gigahertz of spectrum and 256 QAM, the people who figured all that out come together in an organization called 3GPP, the Third Generation Partnership Program. They have they are the people from Nokia, Ericsson, Huawei, AT&T, Verizon, Deutsche Telekom, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And they come together almost constantly through GPP to decide where they're going next. They have done a great job on the technology side. You know it because your cell phones have been getting better every year for the last 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
But they've also come together to get the most money they can for their companies from the consumer.
Right.
Okay. In any other circumstance, if all the phone companies got together and say, hey, how can we design things so customers have to pay more, that would be an obvious antitrust problem. It is an obvious antitrust problem. If anybody brought the suit, there's a very good suit that could be brought, but nobody with money enough to fight a suit like that. Because it's
not in their interest, right.
It's a $100 million lawsuit because the phone companies will fight so hard against it
mm-hmm.
that if you can't put $10 million on the table, you can't have that suit go anywhere in court, and your payoff is going to be 15 years later
mm-hmm.
when the court's resolved. ATIS, the U.S. version of this stuff, clearly breaks the antitrust laws on a regular basis. And they know it, and I've talked it to them, and they have answers, but the real answer is, so sue me, you're not going to get anywhere.
So basically these guys are colluding to keep the price of the equipment high. Is that what's going on?
Well, they want to keep the amount of money going to their companies high.
Mm-hmm.
This is
the equipment manufacturers.
And the phone companies.
And the network operators as well.
So sometimes the phone companies want to keep their equipment prices down, and they make a compromise at the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
One of the most disheartening things they pull is that the royalties now can be more than the total cost of building a low-end cell phone.
Wow. Now, royalties are the payments that gets passed on to consumers for the patents on the equipment. Is that
the
right?
The $50 mobile phones connecting 2 billion more people to the internet, many of which are already connected. Africa, it's probably going to be 2018, not 2017, will have more people on the internet via cell phone than the U.S. has people, 320 million.
Mm-hmm.
India added 50 million 4G LTE customers the last 90 days at one phone company,
wow.
Reliance, who built a new network and wanted to get it filled up very cheap. So they were giving it away. 50 million.
Mm.
Okay. These are the things that are happening because, as I described on the network side, everything's getting cheaper and more powerful, and the phones are getting so cheap.
Mm-hmm.
3GPP has done nothing about royalties that are totally ridiculous. Qualcomm gets $4, $8 off every mid-range smartphone, probably a little bit more on the high ends, the Galaxy.
Qualcomm is the outfit that makes the chips that go in the phone, is that right?
Yeah. They're in San Diego. They're a superb outfit. They're making the best cell phone chips in the world. Their founders, Irwin Jacobs, and Andy Viterbi are two of the finest engineers in the history of wireless. Both have Marconi Awards. They're a good outfit. They deserve royalties, and they deserve to have their research supported. But not at 3 or 4 or 5 times what a reasonable royalty would be. And the system in the U.S. is stacked to make that so. They just got hit with an $864 million fine by the Koreans for overcharging. And the Chinese got over $1 billion from them about a year ago. Okay. Now, 3GPP hasn't done anything about these royalties. You can't even discuss. In fact, one of the things that happened at 3GPP is the Huawei guys, the Alcatel-Nokia guys, and the Ericsson guys fight over whose line code is going to be in the next version of the standard. And whoever gets it in is going to get literally billions in royalties.
Wow.
And what eventually came out of it is the compromise. Each of them is going to have some stuff in the next standard, so they all can get royalties.
Wow.
That's coming on to us, which is one of the problems. IEEE is open to everyone. In fact, had an active program to bring royalties down to something most reasonable. And now they're saying, well, we do Wi-Fi. You've been stamping on our Wi-Fi. We think that we should have something to say about LTE and 5G, because we have academics, independent engineers, small companies, African government representatives, and everybody should be represented in these choices, because frankly, if you don't have everybody represented, it's going to be in the interest of the very large companies that are there. One of the people who said something should be done about 3GPP, bringing in other stakeholders, is named Vint Cerf.
One of the founders of the internet, yes.
And
yes.
He happened to be speaking, so I asked him about it, and he said, of course 3GPP should be more than just the big companies.
Wow.
Let's make some of that happen.
Okay, well, Dave, this is a fascinating subject to be continued, hopefully over the next week or two. In the meantime, we've got to get out of here. I want to thank everybody for listening throughout this year. Wish everyone a happy new year. From Community and Technology. Stay tuned for news of Brother Bill at the top of the hour, followed by Kadir Perez with Nutmeg Jazz in the middle. Rising.
suddenly held me tight. I could see the midnight sun at a night. It's a thrill I still don't quite believe. But after you were gone, there was still some stardust on my
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
It's 37 degrees. It's Wednesday, December 28th. The third day of Kwanzaa, Ujima. Bill DeFosset.